thank you so much, Carol. Wonderful to be here. Wonderful to be compared to Jackie Collins in an odd way. From your lips to the top of the spire to God's ears, as we like to say. I call this particular book my 9/12 book. The book starts on September 12th. I'm joined with everyone here in the great sorrow and loss of 9/11. I lived downtown for 20 years. I was part of the team that developed World Financial Center, now Brookfield Place. I did my research for skyscrapers in the Twin Towers at the Port Authority's archives. And in the subsequent revisions of that book, I have written about this project. In September 10th, 2001, I met with my publisher, and I proposed a book on American memorials. And I had just written a book on church architecture that had been very successful, and my publisher wasn't keen on the idea of a book on American memorials. As he said, Americans aren't really much for commemoration. And the next day, the towers fell, and 7 years later, I came out with the book, Monuments, that is a book on American memorials, and wrote about the temporary memorials of 9/11 in that book. So quite some time ago, I asked Skidmore, Owings & Merrill, whom I've worked with for 25 years, about writing this particular book. And they let me know that that was not a possibility. The Port Authority was not interested in such a book. And I happily returned to chipping away at a 19th century novel about the American Renaissance as it's gathered around Trinity Church in Boston. And that was that, I thought. But then I very fortunately, I guess you could say Elliot Spitzer put his thing where he wasn't supposed to put his thing. And soon enough, Andrew Cuomo tapped Patrick Foy to become the executive director of the Port Authority. Pat knows my work. I know Pat. At a social gathering, I broached the idea again of this book, and finally it seemed like there was a door open. Not very wide, but there was a door open. And long story short, after an extensive, almost year-long proposal to the Port Authority Board of Commissioners, this book was approved. The Port Authority had no editorial say in what I wrote, but what they gave me that was invaluable was access to all of to the site, to their archives, and to all the vendors, all of whom, like me, have signed a non-disclosure agreement. So that is the genesis of this book. I thought I would, I know we have some experts in the room, and I know we have many interested others, so I will tread that middle ground. How does that sound? I thought I'd give you an overview of the project, focus on the symbolic aspects of One World Trade Center, talk a little bit about how to look at this building, how to understand this building, and hopefully clear up a few misconceptions about the project. And then we'll have questions and answers. So buckle your seatbelts because we're going to take off and I have a lot to say and I only have a few minutes to say it in. One World Trade Center is the centerpiece of the new Trade Center. It's an ensemble of 9, soon to be 11, major structures that will be completed about 2020. Right now, One World Trade Center is the tallest building in the city, for now, and in the Western Hemisphere. The entire Trade Center was rebuilt in a climate that was unlike anything that the nation, the world, had ever experienced before. Here's a wonderful view taken from the top of the Trade Center of New York Harbor. This, as you know, is a protected deep harbor. It is a geologic advantage that determined the city's maritime and mercantile fortunes. The Port Authority of New York and New Jersey builds and operates the region's transportation network in an area centering on New York Harbor. It's about 1,500 square miles. They own the World Trade Center site. In 1962, the Port Authority took over the Hudson and Manhattan Railroad. They were forced to, and they renamed it the Port Authority Trans-Hudson or PATH line, in exchange for relieving New Jersey of this unprofitable train line, the authority gained approval to develop the World Trade Center. And this was the brainchild of brothers David and Nelson Rockefeller. When the Twin Towers opened in 1972, they were the tallest buildings in the world. The Port Authority did not want to take on the responsibility of rebuilding the Trade Center after 9/11. But they felt a moral obligation to do so. They had lost 84 of their staff that day. And they were the only agency that had the financial resources to see this project through to completion. The city could not build the project. The state could not build the project. And so one of the things I discussed at length in the book is why the Port Authority. And so they did an extraordinary job. They are known for their landmark engineering structures, like, you know, George Washington Bridge, the Holland Tunnel, the first subaqueous car tunnel, still extremely important. One of the treasures of my new book are these construction shots from the Port Authority's archives. Here's the site in 2008. Just this incredible kaleidoscopic, you know, hive of color and activity. Here we are in 2010. Here it is 2 years ago, and how it is projected to look. This is a rendering. It's a rendering plus a photograph. You'll see Bjarke Ingels, two World Trade Center. I don't know if I have a pointer here. I don't know if that's going to stay in the picture, but let's hope. Right now, 147 World Trade Center, parts of the transportation hub, and the 9/11 Memorial and Museum are open. Liberty Park, which is down here on the southern edge, is going to open by the end of this year. Here we have tiny St. Nicholas Church. This is a Greek Orthodox church that was grandfathered into the site. That should be open by 2018. Up here we have the WTC PAC, the Back Performing Arts Center, that is in the works. Just beyond the site is 7 World Trade Center, which was absolutely catalytic. 2 World Trade Center, built to grade, design is in flux. I'm thinking because Silverstein Properties had to spend so much money on reconfiguring Norman Foster's foundation that Bjarke Ingels has a pretty good shot of hanging in with his cuboid design. 5 World Trade Center, still a question mark. Studio Leaders can master plan the site. And although the firm's name doesn't appear anywhere on any building on the site, its fingerprints are all over it. Daniel Libeskind conceived some of the site's most enduring features. The height of One World Trade Center, everyone knows, 1776 feet, the year the Declaration of Independence was signed. For many years, his proposed skyscraper featured this upraised bayonet-like spire that was, for him, an immigrant to this country, a nod to the Statue of Liberty's upraised arm. In 2002, when Libeskind was in the process of submitting a proposal to plan the site, he came down, and this is what he saw. It's one of his photos, and here we have the excavated pit, not much else, and you see the slurry wall, and it is, the ice is coming through, and that was that image of that ice and the wall gave Libeskind his aha moment. He realized that this could be a key symbol for his project, and in fact, that's what it became. The issue was the slurry wall. The slurry wall held. This is a wall, a bathtub that surrounds the entire site. It's a bathtub that keeps water out, unlike most bathtubs. So the slurry wall had to stay. Had to hold back the water, and if it didn't, that would have been had a catastrophic effect for all of Lower Manhattan, not just the Trade Center site. Parameters were already in place that guided the site's development, most significantly the restoration of Greenwich Street and a number of the cross streets that had been obliterated when the original Twin Towers went up. Everyone knows it was, right, a raised super block. The desire to open up Greenwich Street again, at some point, I am going to figure out who came up with that or who started to campaign for that first, because I'm finding campaigns going on for that in the early 90s. There's a lot of people are claiming this, but we all agree it's a good thing that these streets were opened up. And here's the slurry wall now inside of the 9/11 Museum. And also, very unexpectedly, you can see it on Platform A inside the PATH station, which is really pretty wonderful. Libeskind, as you may recall, had proposed a wedge of light that would, on September 11th, no light would fall between, you know, the first tower being hit and the second tower going down. And whether or not his math was correct, the fact is it was a concept that really captured the imagination. I mean, Libeskind was a very unlikely winner of this call for design ideas, but I think that he succeeded, and I think he was chosen because he had the emotional language, he had the words that people wanted to hear. So the wedge of light was one of those concepts that, whether or not it worked, it really engaged people. Anyway, this is the Calatrava's design. This is the oculus. This is the above ground portion of the transportation hub. And this was not supposed to be in this location. It is located right where Libeskind was going to have his wedge of light, the Park of Heroes. And so Libeskind and Calatrava got together. And I'm pointing here because this sliver of a skylight in the oculus operates, and I guess we'll see this September if it works or not. This is basically recreates Libeskind's wedge of light. Sunlight will come down. And then here's a picture. The Port Authority just posted this afternoon. Thank you, Josh Vogel, who's been such a technical wizard. But I emailed this on my, you know, on the subway to Josh saying, can you put this up? And this is the floor of the Oculus. And here's an early morning shot where you see the Twin Towers again, recreated in memory. I've never seen this image before. So thank you, Josh, for letting me include this tonight. There is something similar going on in the lobby of One World Trade Center, where you will see the two towers enshrined. You can see this in the south lobby, which is a private lobby, but I can tell you later where it is if you want to find it exactly. The building was engineered by WSP Parsons Brinckerhoff, and they engineered 1, 2, 3, 7 World Trade Center, as well as 432 Park, 53 West 53rd, 157, the London Shard, the Shanghai Tower, among many iconic super talls. And I love this photograph. This is by James Ewing, who's a brilliant photographer. I love it because you can see the structure of this tower. This is a hybrid concrete and steel tower. Here in the center, you see the concrete core, and that is surrounded by a perimeter frame in here. You can see it here. So we have a concrete core, and it's surrounded by this moment frame, and this is an extremely strong system for resisting various forces. What was unusual about this, and why it was a huge technological leap forward for skyscrapers in this city, is that because of various union issues, skyscrapers were not ordinarily built with concrete cores. It was always steel first, followed by concrete. After 9/11, the engineers, the architects, the builders, they got together and sat down with the union heads and said, we have to do this better. We have to figure out another way. And so here we have this concrete core, which is stiffens the building very efficiently, but it also contains all of the building's vital systems and exits and staircases, elevators. Now, this is a shot taken two weeks ago of 3 World Trade Center, and now not only is there a concrete core, but the concrete core is going up first. And that is quite revolutionary for New York City. Because of the security concerns, because of the location of the tower, Libeskind placed the tower in the northwest corner of the site. The most vulnerable, most damaged part of that site. SOM, the architects, did not want it there. It would have been easier to place it elsewhere. However, it was decided, George Pataki decided, it was going to be in the northwest corner, and this corner is also the place where 4 PATH trains, live trains, go through. So the entire project, one was built over the live PATH trains. They remained operational, as did the number 1 subway. So because of the security concerns, because of the vulnerability of this site, because of the need to accommodate the PATH train, one is as much a structural solution as it is a design solution or a construction solution. And here we have 1 World Trade Center, and right next to it is 7 World Trade Center. You might be surprised to learn that 7 World Trade Center is a half-pint prototype for 1. All the teams came together at 7 World Trade Center. There was, you know, shovels in the ground in 2002 to start work on 7 World Trade Center, and it brought together SOM, the architects, WSP, the engineers, Silverstein Properties, the developer, the Port Authority, and Tishman, the builder. 7 was catalytic. Many people thought that it was a premature to begin discussing and actually building when everyone was still reeling in a state of shock after 9/11. However, there were very practical reasons for 7 going up. The base of that building housed a Con Ed substation. So Con Ed was using generators to provide power to Lower Manhattan. I'm sure some of you are familiar with this. And that substation had to be, they needed a new substation. So that pushed it forward. However, the teams got together on 7. They worked out a lot of the safety issues, the security issues, many of the sustainability issues, worked on the building code. Many, many things were in place. Most importantly, perhaps, all these working relationships were developed and in place, and then they all moved over and built 1. Here is the podium. This is the podium that 1 World Trade Center sits on. It looks magnificently beautiful in this picture. It's lit at night. You can see the memorial pool in the foreground, and it's this very sparkling, very attractive lower building. It was not without its controversies, unfortunately. I talk about the problems that attended the construction of the base of 1 World Trade Center. Some of you may recall there were issues with the glass that was going to sheath the lower tower. And there were certainly issues with the radome that was to sheath the upper spire. My impression is, and Carol, you can tell me later what your impression is, but everyone basically is not allowed to talk about it. But it's the spire in particular, losing that sheath was devastating for the architects, for Skidmore and Merrill.
By the way, we have the model of the radon, which is on the other side of the gallery.
Oh, good.
The original model of the first One World Trade Center with the diagrid structure.
That's great. So you can see that model, and that's going to give you a sense of what it might have looked like. So what happened was, Larry Silverstein, for various financial reasons, moved, no longer was going to develop one, and he, in exchange, was given 2, 3, and 4. He's developing those buildings. The Port Authority needed a developer with some skin in the game, and eventually took on the Dorst organization as a partner. Not to get too far down the road of these various financial arrangements, but the reality is that there were things that were done to the building that would save the Port Authority money, put some money in Dorst's pocket as well, and two very visible outcomes were the base of the building and the very top of the building. The spire would have been designed differently, I'm sure, if we knew it was not going to be covered. The argument was that because that spire is, that mast is going to host broadcast equipment, it had to be extremely accessible for maintenance. So, interestingly enough, the Port Authority also built George Washington Bridge. And I don't know how many of you here know that that bridge was supposed to be covered with pink granite. 1930, the granite was going to cost $2 million, which is kind of outrageous when you think about it. But the Port Authority nixed it. But because the George Washington Bridge, they had planned all along, was going to be covered with granite, it's got a very muscular structure. My favorite bridge. Different at the World Trade Center, the spire, I think the weight, the proportion would have been different if they knew they weren't going to have the radome. Anyway, some of the things that my book clears up, they clears up actually many things. I have 3 pages of bulleted controversies that I take on. One of the things that is so hard about doing an illustrated book is that, especially one as beautiful as this book, and I can say that because it was a cast of thousands involved, D-Box designed the book. You may know them. They are preeminent creative agency. They render many new skyscrapers so people can visualize what their buildings will look like. But when you do a book that is laden with color, it's one of the ways we reel in the reading public, it's easy to maybe not go into the text as much. But I assure you that if you read that text, and if you read between the lines, and if you consult with the 400-plus endnotes at the end of the book, you will get a good handle on what was happening and why things happened the way they did. One reviewer accused me of being overly celebratory, and honestly, I thought about that, and I thought, you know, I wasn't celebratory enough. It is a miracle that anything at all was built. This project is a Rubik's Cube, so complicated, so interconnected. Buildings are sharing, you know, roofs and walls, so many stakeholders. I mean, I think I've counted 85 official stakeholders, giant agencies with a say in the project, and then a fair swath of the 8 million who call New York home. People from all over the world were commenting on this building. So, but anyway, here we have Larry in the summer of 2001, Larry Silverstein. He has just purchased he's won a bidding war to develop the original Twin Towers, and here he's holding up the, you know, symbolic keys. And so he immediately hired SOM to refurbish the place, and 6 weeks later, the towers fell. So a few things here. One, Silverstein was obligated to replace in kind what was lost on 9/11, meaning almost 11 million square feet of commercial office space. Commercial office space and about 500,000 of that dedicated to retail. That's why there are no residential buildings on the site. He was obligated to continue to pay rent on the site after 9/11, even though there were no buildings standing. And without question, he had the legal right to choose the architects of his choice. And he chose Skid Row and Merrill. Silverstein didn't have a lot of experience in Class A office buildings, but Skid Row and Merrill certainly did and is a global leader in in super tall construction, having designed 7 of the 14 tallest towers in the world. To let that statistic seep in for a moment. Libeskind, on the other hand, had never designed a skyscraper. I did one of the best interviews with Larry Silverstein, if you know him, an absolute character, just a slice of old New York and just as relentless as water on stone. I admire that that drive, and I hope he lives for many more years so he can see his project completed. But he said, you know, he was relaying the story, what he said to Daniel Libeskind, and basically said, Dan, building this tower, building one is the equivalent of open heart surgery. And I don't want to be operated on by someone who's never done an operation like this before. The prologue of the book, this is one of the most interesting chapters. It's the first chapter. And I set the stage for what is to come. The book was originally going to be only about One World Trade Center. I soon realized that all of these buildings, their stories, their construction, they're physically, emotionally, politically, financially, all interconnected. And so now the book includes chapters on all the major structures. This first chapter, however, began its life as an extremely long, 20,000 word long essay on everything that happened between 2001 and 2005. And then my editor said, how about we make it into an illustrated timeline? Now, I'm surprised I didn't, you know, run out and do away with myself. Not the kind of thing you want to hear after you've suffered over 20,000 words. However, I do think that it is was the right solution. This is a long timeline that hits the highlights, the milestones of everything that had to happen after 9/11. So in 2003, the Lower Manhattan Development Corporation, this is the agency that was tasked with planning the rebuilding, held an innovation design study. And it was not a competition. The LMDC put that in 96-point type bold across the top of the RFP. This is not a design competition. But it quickly became so in the minds of the public. The call for ideas morphed into a competition. And I think it was because at that time, and I don't know, it looks like several of you might have been in the city during that time, it was such a climate all over, not just New York City, all over, a climate of, you know, good guys and bad guys and winners and losers. And the whole nation was fervently wanting to rebuild, wanting retribution. It was such an odd time. The nation was on the brink of invading Iraq, and there was a defiant optimism, you may recall, even a large dose of patriotic testosterone. The perception that the LMDC was staging an all-or-nothing contest, however, slowed the rebuilding process. One of many things. One of many intangible things that slowed the building process that were as real as time and money. So the book's opening chapter covers many of the projects that were proposed. It was an extraordinary time for architects. I mean, this was suddenly architects had the most visible profession in the world. From the outset, the LMDC's ability to make decisions was hampered by a lack of clarity, not just on their part, but on the part of many of the stakeholders about whether remembrance or rebuilding was the priority, and by the competing claims made on the project by many, by the port, Silverstein, city, state, the feds, the list goes on and on. I have a chart of all the different stakeholders. That's so many people are there that it's impossible to read at any kind of distance. I think it's fair to say that George Pataki, governor of New York at the time, used the project to fuel his presidential ambitions, and he strong-armed the uneasy alliance between SOM and Studio Libeskind. So the book tracks the evolution of the design. Once Libeskind was chosen to do the master plan, he was he began working with SOM. And so here we have 2003. Here is that bayonet-like form from Studio Levisking. Then we have SOM's design from the same year, and this is tapered tower. This was done in conjunction with engineer Eden Nordenson. Very sophisticated tower, open air structure, culminating in wind turbines. Then we have the combination design by Levisking and SOM, and it's here on the. Here you can see that we still have the bayonet, like spire. We have the 1776 foot symbolic height, and we have the retention of SOM's open air cable structure with the wind turbines. The problem is the way this bayonet structure was designed. It is not an optimal design for an extremely tall tower. What the building wants to do is split apart. So the bayonet design was not a feasible, was really not, never going to be a solution. And the far right, you see the design pretty much as it is today. And you can see the radome covering the spire there. And the canted base, which is still there, but now it's been covered, so there's right angles. In 2004, the NYPD sent a letter about their security concerns. And the letter requested that Tower 1 be moved in about 90 feet from the West Side Highway. They felt it was just too vulnerable a place for it. The letter went missing. Now, you'd think if you wrote a letter saying, could you please move your 3.1 million square foot tower, could you just move it in, just, 90 feet or so, you'd think you might follow up with a phone call. A text, something, right? Didn't happen. So by the time the letter did surface, the design underwent a seismic change. The building had to be moved. Pataki put David Charles and Daniel Levisking together in a room. They had to work it out, and they had almost no time to come up with this design. And at the end of the day, at the end of a long, excruciating day, SOM left the room with 51% control over the design. And so, for all intents and purposes, SOM is now designing the tower. The other thing that was happening was many of the symbolic elements were removed because Larry Silverstein said, I am obligated to rebuild 11 million square feet of commercial office space. I don't want to pay for all these symbolic extras, right? So a lot of things came together. SOM emerged as the designer and worked tirelessly. This is one of many, many photographs that I have of all of these investigative models that SOM built, trying to figure out the building's planes. Right now it is, the final building is 8 isosceles triangles, 4 up, 4 down. The building morphs from a square to an octagon to a square. But you can see, I hope the picture is clear enough for you, all the different tops, all the different possible profiles that they might use. You know, the building had an impossible task. It had to stand tall, and it had to be humble. It had to stand for everything that was lost on 9/11, and everything that was reclaimed. It was impossible. And so what the design is quite extraordinary, I think. The way that it has this giant size, it's 3.1 million square feet, is that it reflects everything in its surface. It is a very, very reflective, very high-end glass that's been used, 13,000 panels, and it reflects everything around it, whether it's the sky, the clouds, the architectures of the 19th and 20th centuries, the faces of people that are walking by. These photos, taken on the same day, same photographer, same camera, shows you the way this building changes. We have the symbolic height of 1776, which is a symbol of American resilience. David Childs, lead architect from SOM, began his career in Washington, D.C. He knows the city extremely well. He designed the new master plan for the National Mall. He chaired the National Capital Planning Commission, the Commission of Fine Arts, both presidential appointments. The point is, he knew the city, he knew Washington Monument extremely well. This is a sketch that David Childs did that shows the relationship of the memorial pools. So it's very symbolic. We go from this emptiness, reflecting absence, as Michael Arad called it, his memorial design, to this tower that rises up. One World Trade Center takes its symbolic meaning from the physical dimensions of the original Twin Towers. That 200-foot square measurement is a measurement of each of the memorial pools. It's also the measurement of the base of one. And even though Yamasaki, who designed the original Twin Towers, really didn't care so much for New York City, he did embed in his design for the Twin Towers that 200-foot square measurement, which is the depth of a typical city block. So it's interesting that this Manhattan's fundamental DNA is in the original towers, in the pools, and now in one. Pretty much no one liked the design of the Twin Towers, and then they fell and everything changed. But one thing people agreed on is that at certain times of day, right now, if we were to go outside, actually, these chamfered corners on the original towers would catch the sun, and they would just run up the building in the most beautiful way. And that is here again. We see that they SOM put these same chamfered corners in, and this building also catches light in that wonderful way. It's also a reference to the chamfered corners of the 9/11 memorial pools. Now, the original World Trade Center was not going to be built on the west side. It was going to be built on the east side. Originally, Skidmore, Owings & Merrill was going to design this World Trade Mart, as it was known. And so in my research, I came upon this publication that the Rockefeller brothers and their colleagues had put together to sell this idea to the public. And what's so incredible is here's SOM's rendering, this is 1960, rendering of World Trade Mart. And I found this and just was stunned to see that same equation in place. We've got a void, these are courtyards, a void, a solid. And there it is. Quite extraordinary to me. Here's a nighttime view. This all can be programmed with different colors. Sometimes it's blue, it looks like this incredible swimming pool, you know, it changes. Here it is, platinum again. And here we have St. Nicholas National Shrine, and this is also another design by Santiago Calatrava, and that's going to be on the southeast corner of the site. And here it is, a tiny little church. It will only seat maybe 200 people, and it's it's a layered facade that will allow this alabaster over here to be eternally lit, and it's going to glow like a little votive candle on the site, expressing, there's the base of one, here's St. Nicholas, and kind of putting a spiritual gloss on the secular motion expressed by One World Trade Center. So, now, Josh, I think this is the video. Hold on, not yet, just hold the, but can you do it?
Yeah.
All right, but it's not gonna start, right?
When you're ready.
Okay. We're almost done. I just want, Josh made this great flipogram for me that shows the book, and it's just, I want to show it to you. It's very short, but it'll give you an idea of some of the graphic inventions that we came up with for the book and the life of the book. And so I wanted to share that with you. Hit it, Josh, and thank you. That is the book. I just want to conclude by saying that as much as writing this book taught me, I'm continuing to learn about the project. My hope with this book is that it will help ease at least some part of the lingering heartache of 9/11. We have all lost people. And I hope, too, that despite all the trouble in this world, that when you see this building coming down the West Side Highway, looking up from New Jersey, you can see it from Staten Island, from Brooklyn, you can see it all over, I hope you remember what human beings are capable of. This is an extraordinary project. It's the strongest building in the world. It was put up by 26,000 people who gave it their all for 15 years. I mean, extraordinary effort. Is it a perfect project? No, it is not. But there is so much that is right about this project. And the biggest thing is that it is on 16 tiny acres. They have put in the equivalent space of 10 good-sized cities, pretty extraordinary, that the city came together, the nation came together, and this was built. Something 43 states contributed to this tower. Love is stronger than death, and hope, the hope expressed by this building, springs eternal. Thank you. I'd love to have some questions.
Could you say something about a project that I recall being called the Phoenix Project? And it was an effort to rebuild the Twin Towers almost identical.
Yes. This gentleman is referring to one of the many proposals to rebuild the Twin Towers exactly as they were, or only higher. And I'm sure you saw the version with the middle finger raised. I know Mr. Garvin did. You know, everybody had a plan. Everybody, two schools of thought. I mean, we can't build anything here. This is sacred ground. Giuliani, right? The book begins actually in 9/12 with Giuliani saying we will rebuild. Pataki decided nothing was going to be built on those 8 acres. There were many proposals. The problem was the Twin Towers, it really wasn't, it wasn't a realistic, just practically speaking, the buildings needed to be better. Those weren't great buildings, you know? So technology has advanced so much in the last 40 years, that it wouldn't be realistic, but many, many people called for that. I was just in Newtown, Connecticut, and I, the site of Sandy Hook, the school where all those children and school teachers died. 40 different sites in within a reasonable geographic area. And they decided in the end to pull down the school and rebuild right on that site. A little bit different in design. I found that a tough, I found that a very difficult solution. I think that's a difficult solution. Do you think that it should, they should have been rebuilt that way?
I originally did in the early years, but then I guess what swayed me was that I think that they should be original buildings and it shouldn't be copies of what came before.
Yes.
Despite the fact that you, you were angered, you wanted to show an expression, let's rebuild exactly, but I came to be swayed that I think they should be original buildings and not copies.
Yeah. I mean, I think that also sends, I think that sends a strong message too, that we were changed by 9/11. So why would we go back and build something that we built, you know, that opened in 1972? It's some extraordinary projects proposed. Anyone?
So I'm talking about rentable square feet for a minute.
Okay.
You showed two diagrams at the beginning. One was the core, and then surrounding the core, the latticework structure of the limit. And the number 3.1 million square feet of rentable square foot exists there. Optimally, if they could do it without worrying about a strength core to guard the walls and the stairways and all, and the elevator shafts, how much square foot could they have put in?
That's a great question. I do not know. Because I, the fact of the matter is, I mean, I'm sure if someone's a mathematician or an engineer, we could figure it out. The walls range in thickness from, you know, 6 feet thick, and they slim up a little bit, you know, toward the top to 2.5 feet, I believe. So, but there was no choice. That concrete core was needed because this building had so many security demands made on it that there really wasn't a choice, but that, well, we could do...
How about this? About what percentage?
You know, I'm not a math person. All right.
What percentage of the total square footage encased in the outer shell is the core? Half?
I would say third, at least.
A third, only a third.
Maybe a half. But you know what? I will find out.
Tell Carol.
I will tell Carol. Mm-hmm. I will. That's, you know what? Great question. I mean, it's kind of one of those interesting wonderings because the fact of the matter is it was never going to happen. But, yes.
Just another, you showed another slide with three renditions of the building.
Yes.
And the first one was in the morning with beautiful reflecting the sunshine. And the last one, and the middle one, I didn't recognize the building.
Isn't it incredible?
The top of the building has something on it on your slide that's not there. Take a look at that slide, and you'll see what I'm talking about.
Spirals.
Am I right? Did anybody else pick up on that?
Spirals.
It's a dome.
Spire was different, and the dome was covered.
We're going to look at that afterwards. You're keeping me on my game. Thank you very much. But I know the photographer very well. So he comes from far, far away. He's not an American. So it's not, I don't think he was fooling around with Photoshop and doing. I know he was there with the camera, but okay. Anyone else?
So SLM spent a lot of effort on a special kind of glass for the base.
Yes.
That had a certain color and sheen and everything.
Yes.
It was way over budget and they canceled it and they replaced it with the colored lights. Was the original design, or could you describe what they originally intended with that special glass that they couldn't?
They had originally designed the base of One World Trade Center because of, again, because of security, again, because of respect for the 9/11 memorial. You will see for 1, 2, 3, and 4, there are no retail facing the memorial, okay? Ordinarily, in a big office tower, the street level is animated with shops and stores and restaurants and glass windows and things that are very attractive. That couldn't happen at the World Trade Center. So at least nothing at One World Trade Center, but the others have the retails on the other, on the other, on the Church Street side. But anyway, SOM had devised a very beautiful prismatic glass that they tried to, that they manufactured, and it wasn't friable in the end, like automotive glass. You know, automotive glass crumbles up into little bits. It was breaking into shards. It was thought that it was too dangerous. They tried like heck to make it work. It wasn't going to happen. And so what you have now are these fins. I don't know if we're off now. These 13-foot high vertical fins that are stationary, but they're placed at different widths, different opening widths, so that it animates the building. And those fins are actually, the colors of that glass are actually quite lovely. Go and look at it. You'll see it's whites and dove grays and lavenders and blues. It's beautiful. But what they did do inside those grand portals, the south entrance of the World Trade Center, One World Trade, is the largest portal ever used in an office building. It's huge, very wanted to convey a sense of welcome, but again, you have that issue of safety. So if you look at that, you'll see the lower level is the concrete core, this concrete wall. It'll be easier with the diagram, but I think this is off now. The concrete wall is sheathed in dichroic glass. This is a specialty glass that breaks the spectrum up into colors. So it has all these wonderful pastel, pale greens, and lavenders that run through it, and that changes according to the light. The upper level, you'll see a cable net wall that SOM devised first for Time Warner, then you see it again at 7 World Trade Center, and that cable net wall basically is another protection against a blast. It acts like a tennis racket. Imagine a tennis racket, the strings goes back and it goes forward. So I do talk about that whole glass controversy in the book. You're nodding as though you had something to do with that glass. No, you didn't? Okay. It's quite a tale. Thank you.
I didn't hear you mention anything in comparison to stability. You know, the original World Trade Center, there was all this discussion
swaying
about its movement. I'm sure there's no question in my mind with the design and the core that has virtually gone away. Is that true?
Yes. On a really, really windy day, like a very windy day, at the top of the tower where it's even windier, the building will sway at most 2 to 3 inches.
Is that in part due to its physical?
It's due to the concrete core, which stiffens it. It's due to the planar surface of the tower, which deflects wind. You know, it's quite a bit has changed since you remember the John Hancock went up in Chicago and people said, you know, their grand piano was flying across the room and all this stuff. No, the building is, if you've been inside. Well, I see my friend Guadalupe is here. Now, what floor do you work on, Guadalupe?
85th.
On the 85th?
Yeah.
What kind of sway are you noticing?
Nothing.
It's remarkable. It's really, I've been in that building many, many times. It's really pretty, it's quiet, and there's no sense of movement. Do you remember going up in the elevators, the old Twin Towers? It's like going to a rodeo. Incredible movement.
I'm a visitor from Seattle, a city of rather unfortunate architecture, and with my friends Ted and Soellen. I really appreciate some of the nuance of the building you described this evening, because it's been a bit lost on me, to be honest with you. I'm a very frequent visitor to the city. I'd be interested in any data you'd have or even anecdotal observations, because it's always struck me that the memorial pools couldn't be better. I thought they captured things perfectly, if that's possible.
Yes.
They're extraordinarily well spoken.
Yes.
The building's always been a bit lost on me, to tell you the truth. It seemed like it was, of course, designed by committee at some level. But you clearly have your perspective. I was wondering how do people feel about the overall project? I mean, as a person from the West Coast?
Well, it's kind of all over the map, because if you were to go down, the place is jammed. I mean, you know, sure. It's no one goes there anymore. It's, you know, it's too crowded. Yeah. You know, there's a lot of visitors there. I'm hoping that the Port Authority will provide more information on the buildings. People are down there and, you know, they're doing everything. Some people are grieving, but many people are taking selfies. Saw someone changing their baby on one of the granite, you know, benches the other day. I mean, there's a lot going on. Now, on one hand, Michael Arad wanted that. He wanted that to be a place of democratic assembly. Arad designed the memorial with Peter Walker. Many New Yorkers have told me, never going down. Another big swath of people have said, and I'd be rich if I had a dollar for everyone who pulled me aside and whispered, I know I'm not supposed to like it, but I do. Mm-hmm. I think if you were here and could see this building, how it remarkably changes over time, that might change. I hope at the very least you'll page through and look at this, all these different personalities that the building expresses.
I was missing a lot from your brief presentation, so thank you.
My pleasure.
What percent of the building is currently occupied, and by who?
Of one? Hmm. I think one's about 70% leased at this point. Pretty good, damn good, considering it's been open for less than 2 years. Buildings, these big buildings take some time. And the big news, of course, was Condé Nast, the media giant, moving into One World Trade, and that just had, you know, made a big shift. So to have that a company of that size and that reach move down to one, it was certainly inspired many other young creatives, media companies to come downtown.
We just had our own coach.
Pardon me?
We just had our own coming the other day on coach.
Oh, coach is going to Hudson Yards, aren't they?
Hudson Yards.
Yes. Yes.
And you went to, with all these handmakers going up and down the wall.
Which is incredible. So yesterday, I took some photos of that wall, of the handbags. It's the most incredible thing, with this construction going on all around it, and then we have these pristine, you know, windows of perfect bags all, you know, lined up in a color-coordinated way. Yeah, it's pretty incredible. In the back.
You mentioned it needed to be in agreement with the unions having to do something with concrete and steel.
Yes.
Could you elaborate a little bit more on that? And I think what you also said was that agreement needs to set a precedent for future construction here in the city.
Yes.
So
concrete cores are used all over the world, especially in seismic zones. They are extremely efficient, they're very stable, and they're very strong. In New York, it was always steel first in terms of the construction, in terms of the unions. The steel workers would create the structure, and concrete would come afterwards. And because of that, the concrete core was not used. But everyone, you know, when I said they got together with the union leaders, they knew they had to create an extremely strong and safe building. And the agreement was that a concrete core was going to be the way to do that. In fact, the steel on One World Trade Center did go up first, and concrete lagged, I think, 10 floors below. So it was steel and concrete, but now we see, certainly on three, as I've shown you, the concrete core went up first. It's not unusual. It's unusual for New York. It's not unusual for anywhere else.
So if nothing else, you know, future construction will look back at this is the One World Trade Center. We'll say, you know, this building would not have been able to be built without this agreement. In fact, when they were building that. So
yes.
This is something that has a precedent that's going to go into the future.
Many, many things will go. This building, even before it opened, was establishing benchmarks for safety, for security, for sustainability, for a green lease in the city. You know, there were so many innovations, so many structural innovations, so many environmental considerations that were new for the time. When you think back to 2002, 49 unions worked on One World Trade Center. I list them all in the book. they did an absolutely incredible job. One, probably the most amazing statistic in this project that is just all kinds of record-breaking statistics is this. No one died building the World Trade Center. That's incredible. You know, back in the day, people, it used to be, the equation was, this is 50, 60 years ago, for every $1 million spent, you'd lose a life. No one died. And I feel like I want to knock on wood, because that is absolutely incredible. And I think that, you know, Tishman did some interesting things. He built this cocoon, first time ever used, basically like a structure around the top of the towers that would catch if anything fell, if tools fell, if someone got that fell, you know. So things like that, safety was an absolute big concern. And I also think, and maybe I'm being sentimental here, I don't think they could bear to lose one more person at that site. My hat's off to the unions. You know, we had a party, April 26th, this book was published, and the Durst organization threw on the 64th floor for the party. It was pretty extraordinary. Carol was there, some people were here. It was an amazing party, 300 plus people. The vibe in the room was so jubilant. And it's not like they were jubilant for me. I mean, yes, my parents were there, they were jubilant for me. I didn't know a number of people there. And it was such a buoyant feeling. And I realized the next day, it was the very first time that everyone who had worked on that project was invited and they had a chance to celebrate. And when you think about it, you know, not the big, because I'm talking about the people who got up at 4 a.m. to go and, you know, go up 1,000 feet and walk on their 10-inch wide steel beam. You know, the workers, the engineers, the builders, all these folks, they got to celebrate this incredible building. Because what's been happening is people look in the paper and they read, you know, what do they read? This design is awful. This took too long. This cost too much money. I've interviewed a lot of the workers, and I have to tell you, I'm not capable of even following the kind of physical, the excruciating physical work they did, have done day in and day out. So I am thrilled. When I say my book's not celebratory enough, I am thrilled to be able to talk about, it's also the first book, talk about the whole project, not just one little piece of it. So, was I lucky? Yeah, thanks.
That seems like an excellent segue to the idea that we should celebrate now with a reception, a toast, a glass of wine and water, which we have over there for you,
yes.
And hopefully a book.
Yeah. And I'd like to just say, I'd like to acknowledge the presence of Alexander Garvin, who was the director of planning for the Lower Manhattan Development Corporation. And such an honor to meet you.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming. Thank you all for coming.
But for many of you know that every month we do an author's talk. This is actually Judith's second author's talk in our series. We have one of considerable interest coming up in July, which is a book by the economist. He's an actual economist, urban economist, who Jason Barr, who wrote a book on building the New York skyline and the history of skyscrapers. And we like lots of talks on skyscraper in New York history. And I know a lot of you have been here for our New York history talks. We also have coming up in August, the Bowery Boys, you know, the famous podcast, are going to be here to talk about their new book. So, and we have a bunch of people in the audience who are authors and who have given talks here before, John Hill and Alice Garvin. And I know that a lot of us lived the history of these last 15 years in the creation of One World Trade Center. We could be, fortunately now that it's not pouring rain anymore, we could all go out there about 100 feet away and look north about 7 blocks and see something that looks pretty much exactly like this. And it's been a long, arduous course in order to realize the rendering that, of many renderings that are chronicled here in the One World Museum of World Trade Center.
So, you know, so many of us here in Lower Manhattan live that history every day of our lives for the last 15 years, and it's really amazing to see the glorious rise, the sunset, the catching of the light of One World Trade Center that you see throughout the city as a really, I think, magnificent sculptural form on the skyline. But the hard, everyday nuts and bolts and concrete of the construction of that building as well is very well detailed in Judith's book. So she is an author who on previous occasions, and I can't even hold these because they're so heavy, has produced a series of these very tall and slender books called Skyscrapers, which has been phenomenally successful, so much so that I think I like to call her the Jackie Collins of architectural history, because in the hundreds of thousands these books have gone out across the world in order to represent the typology of skyscrapers. And they're always a series of one building, one page, a nice, neat, concise description of each one of the projects, and a historical sort of survey going through the history of the skyscraper. So it's not surprising, but gratifying, that for this very thick book, and not so tall, she concentrated on one single building, but there's so much to write about mm-hmm. this project. So I won't go on at length about that. I'll let her, praise for the book is always welcome. I know that that's part of the pay for doing a free author's talk on an evening like this. But let me just say that Judith has this incredible track record of bringing skyscrapers to a lay audience, a general public. And she's really professed that as her mission as a person who's trained in art history and architectural history. She's taken on other topics like bridges as well. And that effort to become a kind of translator for a general public is something that was embraced for this book in particular by the National Endowment for the Humanities, where this year she serves in connection with this book as a public scholar. So the book was subvented in order to keep its very affordable $35 price, so you can get not only a copy here at the museum, but also an inscription by the author this evening, which for value for a beautifully produced color book is really quite astonishing. So with all of those things, Judith has really figured out how to spread the word about this building type for which we share a great fascination. So, Judith.